In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Be'ahavtet Adonai Eloheika, bekol levavka, bekol nafshika, ubekol meodeka. Be'hayu hadaberim ha'ele, asher misabeka hayom al levavka, ekesartam lebaneka, be'artabam, be'beteka, ublekteka, ubaderek, ubshekbeka, ubekomeka, ekesartam leot al yadeka, be'hayu letotavot. Ben Eneha. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. Therefore you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. Take to heart these words which I am giving you today. Deal them into your children. Speak of them at home and abroad, whether you are busy or at rest. Bind them at your wrist as a sign, and let them be a pendant on your forehead. Write them on the doorposts of your houses and on your gates. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Okay. Magandang gabi po sa kanilang lahat. Just checking with the prayer para sa ating sound. Kasi mukhang may problema. By the way, you can send a text message dito kung sound is the, okay, kasi kanina medyo nagluloko dahil siguro matagal nang hindi nagamit yung ating what is this sound system. Kaya habang hinihintay natin yung 8 p.m. few minutes before 8 p.m. Nag-report na si Virginia de la Cruz Mendez. Good evening, Father Randy, sabi niya. At Ate Sol Garcia Ong, good evening, and all my online classmates. Ba? Ganda naman pakinggan yun, online classmates. Si Elizabeth Manzano, present po, Father, sabi na Lina V. Barsueno. Good evening, Father. Marimel Bautista, praise the Lord. Niya. Rosemary, good evening. Present. Audio okay. Wow. Paki-comment na. Kasi kanina, habang inaayos ko, nag-luluko eh. Good evening, Father. Sabi ni Ramon Villarente. Peter Corona Poso from San Jose, Manggagawa Parish, Montalban. Good evening, everyone. Sabi ni Deng, Tenko, Judith Basquinas, present po, Father. At magandang gabi po sa lahat. Tennessee, Valencia, asama si Ito Banson, and of course, ang Valencia family. Julia Amandoron, Masongsong, good evening to all, sabi niya. T. Amelie G., good evening. Tess Importante, Albert and Freda Hemora, Christ the King, Diocesan Shrine of Jesus, the Divine Word, Bing Casila, especially good evening to the students and alumni of CTS Divine Word Seminary Theology. Lucy Rodrigo and si Brother June Buena, ang ating lay coordinator ng Diocese of Cubao. Huwag niyong kakalimutan na itong ating biblical online Bible study ay under the aegis ng biblical apostolate ng Diocese of Cubao, kasi dati nga nung wala pang pandemic ay nakakaikot, naglalakbay yung Biblia, kaya lakbay Biblia, nagbibigay sila ng Bible Apostolate animators ng Diocese of Cubao ng Bible study around the parishes ng Cubao. Eh kaso talagang hindi pwede ngayon ng big crowd, kaya let us do it muna pansamantala dito sa online study natin. We hope it is only temporary. Marty Grace Luna, Lulat, Brother Larry Manzano, Faith Muhangin, Linda Ifurong, sound is clear, okay, thank you. Sok Osorio, audio po, okay naman, sabi niya. Fermans, Evangeline Romulo, and Presi Dueñas Chu. Si Doc Nati, okay pong dating sound sa akin dito sa Intramuros. Oo, eh, daming nagdasal kay Doc Nati. Praise the Lord. Vanel, si Minor Generalao, Angie, okay naman pong sound. Si Ro, Rex Oroy, at Lydia Menor, V, Badayos, Father Ronnie, Balili sa mula sa ano pa to, Africa, at Evangeline Romulo, Brother Larry Manzano, Marci Dalde, at Romeo Tambuboy, Art Bautista from Holy Family Parish, Dory Resurrection, at Presi Chu, and Mini Vargas, Ray Andrada, Tere Canon, Dolly Medina, Socorro Moralina, si Nino Versosa, the Incense Sign of the Jesus Divine Word, Berna Carmelo, El Ning Liarenas, at Villante, Brother Chito Soriano. Ayan. So, congratulations sa mga nakatapos nung ating fourth cycle ng Pentateuch, about the Pentateuch. I will announce what to do with the certificate kung gusto niyo ng printed out. Anyway, welcome back sa ating Bible, online Bible study. We thank the Lord. We praise the Lord dahil we are still alive and kicking, no? After I ran out of counting already, hindi ko na nagbibilang kung ilang buwan na tayo naka-lockdown. The Lord naman gives us so many opportunities. Kaya lang, pag nakakarinig ka nga rin ng mga kakailala natin, mga kaibigan, mga taong nahihirapan, at saka nawawalan ng mal sa buhay, o nasa ospital, it reminds us that we double our effort to pray and to extend whatever we can do to help one another. Okay? So, ang topic natin ay the former prophets. So, I will explain kung ano yung bakit former. And then, so, dapat kung may former, may latter. Yeah, of course, meron. But let me do it later on. So, ito yung time pa rin natin, 8 p.m. I project na mga 7 sessions siguro ito kasi we cannot finish yung first topic natin ngayon dahil may mga ad-lib at may mga introduction. Kasama na dito, siyempre, yung pag-welcome sa mga newcomers if ever they are participating tonight. No? Talk about prophecy, kasi ito yung title natin, The Former Prophets. Pag nagtuturo ako ng prophets, I always warn yung mga students na yung salitang propesya o prophet o prophecy eh slippery concept, no? Maraming ibig sabihin eh. At all of them are correct in one sense, in one way or another. Depende kasi sa tingin mo kung anong ibig sabihin ng prophecy. It's a slippery word, no? May nagsasabi pa nga sa akin, Father, parang propeta ka kasi may mga nasabi ko na after some time na-confirm ng mga events, no, na nangyari. Pero propeta din si Nostradamus, no? Nanghuhula, Madam Auri, na huwag din siyang propeta. Yung novela, famous novel ni Khalil Gibran, how many millions of copies sold. Eh si, yung character niya doon ay prophet din, no? Propeta din, si Al-Mustafa. Muhammad, no? The founder of religion, founder of Islam, is also the prophet, as well as the Felix Manalo, founder ng Iglesia ni Cristo. He is called to be angel, of course, messenger from the East, messenger angel, prophet from the East as well. And the third, Elijah. Yung first Elijah siguro, yun yung original Elijah sa lumang tipan, prophet Elijah. Second Elijah is John the Baptist, mistaken as Elijah. And the third Elijah, the third prophet, Felix Manalo. So, sinabihan din kami minsan ng aming head ng SBD, si Father Marquez, Jerome Marquez, na sabi niya, sa panahon ng pandemya, dapat kayo'y mga prophets of hope, sabi niya, propeta ng pag-asa. So, ang dami ibig sabihin ng prophet. This is slippery concept. No? After siguro mapag-aralan natin lahat ng mga prophetic books, maybe there you can form yung idea or your definition kung ano ang propeta. So maybe that is the what you can you deduce yung conclusion from the different presentations na gagawin natin. So towards the end, it's good to say, oh, this is what it means. Kung ano ibig sabihin ng propeta. So, hindi ibig sabihin iisa lang ang meaning niya. Malimit, ang pinakapopular na meaning ng propeta ay parang kay Nostradamus nga, yung manghuhula ng iyong kapalaran, ng iyong kinabukasan, foretelling of the future. Yun yung usual, normal, popular, I should say, na pag sinabing prophet, that's the first thing that comes into your mind. So, pero that's not the only meaning of prophet. As you will see later, dito sa study natin ng Old Testament prophets. So, session 11 na tayo, binilang ko, well, we ended up with session 10, kaya tuloy-tuloy natin. This is session 1 for the prophets, but actually already session 11. Dito sa ating online Bible study. At ang first book na ating tatalakayin, the first of the prophet, prophetic books, so una sa mga prophetic books, and I will explain later, ay hindi yung mga propeta na kilala ninyo, Isaías, Jeremias, or Jonah, or Hosea, but in the listing of the Jewish Bible, the Hebrew Bible, the Bible of the Jews, the first prophetic book is not Isaiah, but the book of Joshua. Okay. So, ito yung topic natin ngayon. And I'm pretty sure hindi natin matatapos kasi nga may mga adlib pa bago tayo pumasok dito sa Book of Joshua. Now, nung may mga comments, nag-comments noon na anong sabi nila sa akin sa comments natin, ay, gusto nila ng assignment, gusto nila ng babasahin. Well, ang daming pwedeng basahin, I can give you. In fact, I made it already. I made the line up already and I will give you yung link yung nasa website ko. Kaso, as I said, the best preparation, the best study, kayo nang magbabasa mismo. You read the text itself. You read the book itself. Yun yung pinaka-assignment natin. So, I give you the introduction. Sometimes the introduction become complicated because I also share with you modern issues coming out from those books. No? Hindi lang yung pe-present kung anong laman niya, pero ano ang mga tanong at ano ang mga issues na that are sometimes tackled sa in a higher Bible studies or sa schools of theology. So yun yung assignment na natin lahat, actually, natin lahat. Kasi kahit na nabasa ko na yung book of Joshua 11 beses, hindi naman photographic memory tayo, katulad ng mga ilan na may photographic memory, you will forget again the story. Maybe the gist, you know, but you will forget again this, especially the details. Kaya hala, basa ulit. Nung nag-aaral kami ng Biblia sa Roma, yung first book na pinabasa sa amin in the Hebrew language, you know, we have to translate word for word from Hebrew to English, is the book of Joshua. So from that, naalam ko na yung laman niya sa Hebrew, pero still, nung naghahanda ako para sa klase na ito, at saka klase sa isang seminaryo, I reread again once or twice the book of Joshua. And it is not an easy book, even though it is, the narrative is easy, yung pagkukwento niya, kasi nga, is war stories, pero one of the more challenging books pagdating ng biblical studies, ang libro na ito, the book of Joshua. So, you'll have time. I'm advertising it that you take a look of that book and read as long as we have time, which we have naman sa panahon ng pandemyang ito. No. So, ay nabanggit ko kanina yung Hebrew Bible. Sa Hebrew Bible, I mean, this is the Hebrew Bible, which is the Jewish Bible, from, ang tawag natin Old Testament, pero may slight differences ng Old Testament, kasi nga, we have more books sa Old Testament kaysa yung Hebrew Bible. And the arrangement of the books are different. Sa Hebrew Bible, at saka Old Testament. So, if you are using the Hebrew Bible, which we must use the Hebrew Bible because that is the Jewish Bible from which the Old Testament was drawn, no? We also be aware kung ano ang kanyang arrangement, nilalaman. And it has a different arrangement. Kaya, ang unang parte ng division niya ay yung Torah, Pentateuch. Okay, that's the first division. And then the second division ay prophetic books na. Prophets. At ang unang parte, at ang prophets are divided into two parts. The former prophets and the latter prophets. Okay? And yung isa-isahin ko mamaya yung mga pangalan ng mga libro. At yung pangatlong division ay yung et cetera or writing. So, very easy. Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible na diniscuss natin. Pero instead of so-called historical books, right away, ang next na kanilang sa list, the groupings, ay the prophets. And the prophets are divided into two parts, the former prophets and the latter prophets. And then, the rest na. The writings, etc. Pwede mo namang sabihin. Now, sa Christian Old Testament, has traditionally been arranged along different lines. After the Pentateuch comes a series of books that continue in roughly chronological order, yung history ng Israel, kaya nga tinawag siya na historical books. That's the term that we are using for the sinabi kanina na former prophets. Historical books ang tawag natin as sa ating ano. So, once again, sa Jewish Bible, Hebrew Bible, the division is three, Torah, Pentateuch or Pentateuch, second ay yung prophets, and then etc. or writings. Sa Christian Old Testament ay apat. Nabanggit ko na ito yung mga first session natin.
yung Pentateuch. Then followed by historical books. And then you have, of course, the sapiential books or the wisdom books or the poetic books. And last, prophets. So, 1, 2, 3, 4. Yung 4, 4, 4 na tinawag ko noon. No? So, that's sabi ko na may difference sa arrangement. No? Yung Hebrew Bible at saka Old Testament. Now, yung former prophets, yung tinatawag at yung topic natin sa 7 sessions na ito, projected, ay anim ang saklaw niya na libro, yung former prophets. Okay? Joshua, Judges, 1st and 2nd Samuel, 1st and 2nd Kings. Actually, 4 lang yan sa original arrangement. Kasi yung 1st and 2nd Samuel is considered one book, was considered one book. 1st and 2nd books of Kings considered one book sa originally sa Hebrew Bible. So, all in all, you have only 4 former prophets. But later on, siguro for more practical reason, para makontain doon sa scroll, ay lalo na nung masyado namang mahaba pag hindi mo paghihiwalay. Eh. So, now we have subdivided them into 6 books. Yun na yung sinusunod natin, yung 6 na libro. So, ang tawag natin dyan, tawag ay former prophets or part ng historical books, which the usual know later. No? So, ito yung historical books na tinatawag, pero hindi lang hanggang Second Book of Kings ang historical books. No? It is divided into this one. Yung first grouping niya ay the Deuteronomic history. Okay? So, ito yung historical books, tinatawag ko kanina. At yung historical books, ang first division niya or ang first group niya ay Deuteronomic history or the former prophets. If you are using the Jewish Bible, you call it the former prophets. If you are studying, you are a scholar, you are doing a serious Bible study, scholars call this group Deuteronomic history. Naipaliwanag ko na ito noon dahil nga yung yung theology na nananalaytay sa 6 na book na ito ay inspired by the book of Deuteronomy. At ang isip pa nga ng maraming scholars ay yung gumawa ng libro ng Deuteronomy must be similar or sharing the same idea, if not the same person or group of persons who edited, who composed, who put together yung group na former prophets na tawag natin. Kaya nga, today, scholars call it the Deuteronomic history, or sometimes you hear the word Deuteronomistic history, pare-pareho lang yan, or the former prophets. So, yan yung first part ng historical books. I hope I am so we have as Christian Old Testament, sa Christian Old Testament, sa Biblia natin ay ang unang parte ay Pentateuch, pangalawang parte ay historical books. Yung historical books na ito, mahaba. No? At unang parte ng historical books ay Deuteronomistic history or the former prophets. Ito, 6. And this is our topic for this cycle, for the second round. Ito. Okay. Now, after the Deuteronomistic history or the four prophets, the second group sa historical books ay Chronicles, history ang kategory niya. Ito yung tawag ng mga scholars sa section na ito, the Chronicles history. At it is composed sa First Chronicles, First and Second Book of Chronicles, Ezra, Nehemiah. Okay, so the Chronicles history. So maybe God willing, after ma-discuss natin yung former prophets and the latter prophets, i-continue natin yung historical books with the study on the Chronicles history. So ito naman, isang section din ng pag-aaral ito, the Chronicles history, the second part ng historical books. The third part ng historical books ay yung Maccabees, history of the Maccabees. Ito yung third section ng history. Bakit hinati-hati? Kaya iba-iba kasi yan ng let's just say author or authors. Magkakaiba yung style nila. Kaya they belong to one, that they are grouped according to literary styles or the literary genre, or na-explain ko na noon mga first outing natin, at yung theology, yung pagtingin niya sa Diyos, pagtingin niya sa pangyayari, and of course yung chronology niya, yung date niya, yung context niya ng mga events, magkakaiba. Kaya we put them into those na kategorya. So the Maccabees, the first and second Maccabees. Sa mga nag-aaral na ng Biblia, alam nila na itong first and second Maccabees belong to what we call the deuterocanonical books. Ano ibig sabihin niyan? May mga books tayo na sa Roman Catholic Bibles and the Orthodox Catholic Bibles and the Coptic or not Coptic, Ethiopic, no? Ethiopic Christians, Ethiopic means Ethiopia, doon sa kanilang listahan ng mga libro, meron din sila nito. So, but in the Jewish Bible, plus the Protestant Bibles, they do not have these books. So, kaya ang tawag natin ay deuterocanonical books. A canon is, that is apart from the first na list ng mga books which is in the Jewish Bible. So, first and second book, Maccabees. That's the reason why magkaiba yung ating listahan or number of books. Do not worry, and that should not scandalize you bakit magkakaiba yung mga number of books. There is a long explanation ito, and sometimes it takes up sa seminary at least mga 1 month explaining the history kung bakit iba-iba yung number of books na meron tayo ngayon. But the shorter explanation nito ay dahil yes, magkakaiba, that shows na mayaman ang history ng Judaism and Christianity, no? They did not just limit themselves sa mga itong libro na ito, but they accepted other books. Kaya magkakaiba ngayon yung mga listahan natin. It should not scandalize it. It should therefore make us appreciate the wealth and the richness of the biblical tradition. So, first and second Maccabees, God willing, if we will have time, we will also later on, kaya mahaba nga yung Bible study kung wala pa tayo sa New Testament, no? The fourth section on the last ng historical books ay yung historical, tinawag na historical sounding Midrash. Midrash means Jewish story. It's a story na may pagka-legendary yung mga characters, no? But narrated in historical manner. May mga ganyang ano eh, like what for example, yung legend o that is told in a narrative way, in historical narrative way. Limahong maybe, or the story of Lamang in Ilocano, for example, no? Those are fictional characters, no? But they are narrated in like a, in as if they live, no? As if they are historical figures, no? So well, I will, when we reach this point, I will again elaborate it pagdating ng panahon na pag-aralan natin itong group na ito. And the group na ito ay Book of Ruth, Esther, Judith, and Tobit. Again, yung may asterisk dyan are under the category na Deutero canonical books, yung Judith and Tobit. You do not find that in the Jewish Bible nor in the Protestant Bible, but you find that in the Catholic Bible, First Eastern Orthodox Bible, Ethiopic Bible, yung Judith and Tobit. Maybe some of you will be raising eyebrows, bakit si Ruth naging historical sounding midrash o legendary figure or a fictional character? I-table muna natin ito, otherwise hindi tayo matatapos. I-tackle natin pagdating ng panahon. So, again, yung four divisions ng historical books, you put, para nasa context kayo, the first part, the Deuteronomistic history, which is also called the former prophets. Six books. Ito yung topic natin ng seven sessions. The second part sa historical books ng Old Testament natin ay the Chronicles history, four books doon, from the first and second book of Chronicles to Ezra and Nehemiah. And then the third part ay yung mga Maccabees, so the first and second Maccabees. And then the fourth part, yung Midrash, history-sounding Midrash, the book of Ruth, Esther, Judith, and the book of Tobit. My favorite dito ay the book of Tobit. And if you have time, you read the side, kung nabasa nyo na yung Joshua, then take a look sa libro ni Tobit, especially now during the time of pandemic. It's about charity, burying the dead, you know, as a form of charity, form of following the Torah. So that's the okay. Just checking kung may mga complaints sa sound and image. Wala naman. Puro nag-good evening. So feel free to say something pag medyo alanganin yung sound, alanganin yung ano, kasi monitor ko la, ay nagmo-monitor ako, kaso soundless dahil nga mag-e-echo dito sa ating kwan, sa microphone natin. So that's yung journey to the historical books na may 16 books all in all. God willing, maaabotin natin ito. So let's go to the book of Joshua. No? Now, bago, synopsis lang muna, no? Para agad-agad yung laman niya na agad. So, pero walang kapalit to pag kayo na mismo ang nagbasa. And many things you will discover there. And many questions that you will be asking, especially things that can be scandalous sa na napaloob sa libro na ito. Synopsis. the story of how the Israelites entered the land of Canaan to create a homeland. How many times na uulitin yung land, the land, the land, the land? Eretz, sa wikang Hebreo. No, Eretz, Eretz. Ilang beses niyan. So, it is therefore a story not only about Joshua, but about the land, the entry to the land. And the land of Canaan, before it becomes the land of Israel, is the land of Canaan. And then, under the leadership of Joshua, they possessed the land as the fulfillment of the promise. Remember the promise far away, all the way from the book of Genesis. So, in fact, yung mga ibang scholars had proposed, I don't know kung mayroon pa nagpo-propose, pero they had proposed, pinupose nila na hindi dapat Pentateuch pag nag-aaral ang first division ng Biblia, but should be Hextateuch, sabi nila, no? Hextateuch, meaning six books. Kasi nga, yung ending noong story is the possession of the land, the entry to the land. Yun naman ang pinangako doon. Eh, bakit hihinto ka sa kamatayan ni Moses, which is the first, which is the end of the book of Deuteronomy. The death of Moses, hindi pa nga sila nakakapasok sa land, which was promised in the book of Genesis. That was the parang nanonood ka ng telenovela o sine, tapos hindi natapos. Yung problema nila, yung possession of the land, it was promised to them. Eh, patay na yung namumuno sa kanila, si Moses. So, ano na? Anong story? Anong mangyayari? Yeah. So, sabi ng mga ibang scholars, maybe, it should not end in the Pentateuch should not be five books but six books. Six is hexateuch, no? Six books, not Pentateuch. Hexateuch. Anim. Oh, it makes sense, no? Na yung story ends with the entry of the people of God, the Israel, under this time under the leadership of Joshua, to the land, to the Eretz that was promised to them. So, pwede nyong kung gumagawa kayo ng story, eh, that is really a good one, a good ending of a story. You know? So, bakit naman hanggang dun sa kamatayan mo? So, there were scholars who really wrote about it and defended it that the Pentateuch should not be limited to the five books but to the next book, which is the book of Joshua. You see how important the book then as a kumbaga connection, as a hinge sa Pentateuch. Now this is the literary structure of the book. Okay, the so-called outline or the design of the book. The first 18 verses of chapter 1 would focus on Joshua being the, let's just say substitute, or the word that was used is assistant to Moses. Meaning he will not be the replacement of Moses. Moses is irreplaceable. Walang makakasubstitute sa kanya. Naipaliwanag ko na ito noon. So, the one who would come after him is an assistant. So, Joshua. And you have his introduction there sa kung sino siya sa chapter 1 to 18. And then, begins the conquest of the land from chapter 2 up to chapter 12. Ito na yung hinihintay natin. Papasok na sila but they will have to fight for it. And after that, the division of the conquered cities to the tribes, you presume na tagumpay sila. We presume, kasi in chapter 13, 21, yon, parte-parte na sila. Division of the conquered cities. And then, 22 up to chapter 24, katulad ni Moses, Joshua makes a farewell address. Lahat ng mga bida, kung napapansin nyo sa Biblia, bago sila maglaho sa story, sa kwento, or before their demise, before their death, lagi silang may farewell address. Number one na si Jesus. Ang haba-haba yung kanyang farewell address sa Gospel of John. You have the farewell address of Stephen in the Acts of the Apostles. You have the farewell address of Paul. You have the farewell address of Moses. You have the farewell address of Jacob. And the farewell address of here, Joshua. So, you better prepare your farewell address. Outline of the book, another point of view is when you see it from the point of view of war, giyera. So let us see. Pag giyera ang pinag-uusapan, part 1 would be the military campaigns in chapters 1 to 12, wherein the Lord will commissions Joshua, and then the spy the land, ispihan nila yung land of Canaan, tatawid sila sa Jordan, and then the sacrifice sa isang designated place. So, you have the military campaigns. And then yung part 2, chapter 6 to 12, they tell you the stories from a military point of view on how they conquered the major cities. Jericho, Ai, city of Ai, AI, not artificial intelligence, southern city-states, the southern city-states, the Hazor, and other list of conquests. And then, part 3 would be the settlement of the tribes, or the division of the conquered cities, or the assignment of the territories. And part 4, yung ending ng military campaign, is the renewal of the covenant. So you have a worship across the Jordan, and then address or farewell speech of Joshua to the leaders, and then a renewal at Shechem, which is the center of the southern tribal league of the tribes. In the north, Shechem is in the north, of the northern league. Maybe you can call it that way. So, you see, a Shechem. I'll show you some maps later. You see that it is a what impression do you get from this just simple presentation of the outline? And first, you can read the story of Joshua from the point of view of the protagonist, the bida, the character Joshua, the leader, or from the point of view of the military campaigns. And you probably will notice the centrality of the land, yung land ang issue dito. So let us then see some maps. This is the map roughly of the conquest of Canaan. Canaan is the locals, original inhabitants of the land of Israel. So then we have already a big problem. You probably thought that Joshua will enter the land and there are no inhabitants. It's just like you go into a place that nobody is there. No one is there, like a remote island or a remote. But that is not the case. There are always locals, no? And the locals here are the Canaanites. And what to do with them? They are there. Well, from the book of Joshua, kill them, exterminate them. Which poses a big problem to us, modern people today. How come? So it was so scandalous that one Christian writer in the towards the 3rd century, around 2nd century I suppose, AD, it was so scandalous that he rejected the Old Testament. He said the Old Testament cannot be a Christian book because of he was scandalized by these stories that you find in these books, number one in the book of Joshua. So let us see, this is the north, you see Shechem there, this is in the north, Samaria today, that's the place of Samaria today. And you see the north of God, in the north is Galilee. Galilee, as we know, is the place where Jesus moved around and preached and talked, no? There. No? Up north, you have Sidon and Tyre. Sidon is today's Lebanon, and you have Syria, of course. And these are the cities that they would conquer. And you will see there, of course, the famous name, the famous city, Jericho. So when they say Transjordan, across the Jordan, this is Transjordan. They will cross the Jordan River. First they go to Jericho. That's the first city, major city, big city that they will enter to. So and then so you have to, it's very simple ang map ng Holy Land actually. Just two bodies of water. Just remember the two bodies of water, the Dead Sea, and, sorry, let me erase yung ano. Two bodies of water, very simple. Drawing ka lang na ganyan, dagat ito, dagat, okay, dagat yan, the sea, okay, Karagatan. So nasa west, no? West is north, no? North, west, okay, then east and south. This is the south. So towards the west, dagat. Mediterranean Sea. Across the Mediterranean Sea, Greece, Turkey, Turkey, Greece, Europe, Italy. So across the Mediterranean Sea. Pero yung karamihan ng mga Israelites will not settle here sa malapit sa dagat. Nandyan yung mga Philistines, which they will encounter next book sa book of Judges. So they will not settle it. They will settle in the central highlands. Dito, ang pinakamahirap na lugar ay nasa Jerusalem kasi harsh ang mga ano doon, ang walang ulan, walang. So they will move, the northern part would be the richer part. So two bodies of water, Sea of Galilee, the Dead Sea. Okay, so madali lang. Mag meron kang two bodies of water, ma-identify mo na in the north is Sea of Galilee, in the south, Dead Sea. So alam mo na kung nasaan yung north and south and east and west. Now, that's geography. Someday you will go to the Holy Land, or those who have been to the Holy Land, they know better than what I am saying now. No? Now let's see more some stories before we enter to the intricacies and the difficulties of the and the historical questions dito sa Book of Joshua, so that i-brainwash ko na kayo. Kumbaga, may mga preliminary warnings para you have a wider understanding pag binabasa niyo na ito, and you will not be like Marcion. Marcion ang tawag yung sa taong Kristiyano siya na naiskandalo, kaya tinuro niya, ang galing pa niya na magturo sa after the time of Jesus na ito, si Marcion. Google niyo na lang yung kasaysayan ng buhay niya, pero known siya sa pag-aaral ng Biblia. Siya yung nagsabi, maybe the very first person nagsabi na ang lumang tipan ay hindi dapat Biblia ng Kristiyano. Meron pa rin mga Kristiyano nagsasabi ng ganun, pero very few already. If you have that kind of position or belief, that's of course heresy. That was, kasi Marcion was declared heretic. From the very beginning, the Christians, even during the time of Jesus, considered the Old Testament as a book, as an inspired book, as the Word of God, already from the time of Jesus. So you cannot appeal now and say, I do not like the Old Testament. Ang dami diyang karahasan, rape, war, violence, no? Anti-women, anti-children, anti-nature, anti-environment. So that's Marcion. He rejected the Old Testament. So anybody who has that kind of idea now is called Marcionite. Kasi yung movement niya was the Marcionism. Nag-create siya ng movement, Marcionism. So we can just become Martians today at sabihin natin the Old Testament is not a Christian book dahil violence ang karamihan dyan at ang Diyos dyan ay mapaghiganti, gerero, mandirigma yung Diyos dito sa Book of Joshua, may holy war, elimination of enemies of indigenous peoples like the Canaanites. What kind of God is it? So you will have really a lot of theological questions involved. You will be asking once you enter seriously and once you read seriously the Book of Joshua. So right at the beginning, i-orient ko na kayo sa kung ano ang take ng mga scholars dito. So first, of course, sa pag nag-aaral sila ng history o kasaysayan, especially biblical history, history is about records, both written cultural facts or outside the land itself, writings of other civilizations that might have in contact with, for example, Israel. So, why are we talking about history here? Because in the Book of Joshua, as you notice, it is now beginning to for Israel to form a nation. Ano ang definition ng nation? May lupa ka, may lupain, may land. Land is the number one criterion, batayan na ang bansa ay isang bansa, ay nasang nasyon. Pwede ka bang maging nation na walang bansa, walang land? Rohingya, for example, kaya wala silang land, no? They are refugees. Sino ba ang mga walang Bajaw, yung mga local indigenous. So you need once you have the possession of the land, that begins formally the history of Israel as a nation. Now, ganun ba ang start of Israel as a nation? Okay. The one that you find in the Bible, in the Book of Joshua. How do you collaborate that na yun ang story niya so that you can use that story in the Book of Joshua to legitimize yung history ng nation ng Israel na ganun na coming from that story of the Book of Joshua. So, pag historians na maayos, hindi lang sila nagsasettle doon sa literary story na nasa Biblia. Okay? That's only one that they one of the consideration. Kasi history is you examine all possible records, compare them, collaborate them, critique them. Tignan mo kung yung mga stories doon ay might be fictional, might be projection of aspirations of people, or when kailan ba sila naisulat, anong context na sinusulat niyan. So those are questions, critical questions that are being asked. So the next move then, if they're going to study the book of Joshua, is to go out from the book. Where do they go para makita nila yung sinasalaysay doon sa book of Joshua might have some relationship with what? Sa mga cultural remains of the past. Yan na yung business na archaeology. Yan. Dito muna tayo magsasettle ngayong gabi. Archaeology. So, you have the biblical text, no? Pero once they examine history, they will not just rely, they will not just limit themselves to that particular book to understand yung beginning ng Israel bilang isang nation, okay? But also go out and check other resources, other records, written records usually. If there are no written records, cultural remains of the past. And paano mo mapoproduce yung mga cultural remains? There is a science for that. And the science is archaeology. Okay? The study of the cultural remains of the past is itself an independent science. Kaya may science of archaeology to either collaborate, critique, or give a better context, a wider context of what the book of Joshua or other books of the Bible are telling about. So, tingnan nyo, ang Bible study can be very complicated. So, thanks be to God, you are not into that. And thanks be to God na may mga ganyang mga archaeologists, scientists, historians na sila yung nagbibigay sa atin ng data and then we interpret them. And kaya Bible study can be very interesting as well as the unending. So, okay. Now this is is an Arabic word, what they call atel in the Arabic word. Atel is a mountain, ito, pero hindi lang siya bundok, simple na bundok na ito. They found out na itong bundok na ito ay actually ruins, no, of cities over another. So pag yung isang city ay nasira na, another city, new city will be built on that. So layers and layers of civilization. Kaya pag punta ka sa Israel, may mga ganito. Akala mo hill, akala mo bundok, pero yun pala, layers and layers of civilizations of the past. Ang tawag nila dyan ay tel, which is Arabic word for mountain. Kaya may Tel Aviv, di ba? Yung capital city ng Israel. Capital city of Israel is Jerusalem, pero where the airport is called Tel Aviv. Aviv is spring. So, it's the mountain of springtime. So, tell. So huhukayin nila yan. Hanggang sa ilalim. No? O hanggang sa, huwag naman masyado dyan. Dito. And then, madedate nila kung ano yung layer na yan. Katulad niyan. This is another, This is a picture that I took when I was a student. This is another view of Atel. Kung makikita nyo, may mga bahay na dito. I think this is in the north. When we went to the north, somewhere in Samaria. So, tell ito. Akala mo bundok ito. It's not a mountain. Pero it's a tell. Meaning, layers of civilization, one after the other. Pag masira yung isang city, they will build another city over that. Another city over that, layers and layers of civilization until yung pinakamataas, of course, is the latest na city, yung civilization. So, para malaman mo, huhukayin na lang until sa pinaka-first na civilization. And they have a way to date that. Kasi science nga, archaeology sa science. So, may mga, criterion na established at accepted by many scholars how to date whatever they found in those tells. So, ito yung, for example, ito yung excavating a tell. So, kita nyo yun, hukay nila hanggang sa pinaka-base. And then every layer dyan, may madedate nila. Meron silang way. And ito, what they call stratigraphy. So, kung anong mahahanap nila doon, for example, may makita silang hearth doon, o pottery. So, itong layer na ito, may age na ito, may century na, kung ano ito. No? Tapos, alam na nila, kasi yung matagpuan nila dyan, they will date that, depende sa art ng pottery, for example. So, kung nasaan nakalagay yung pottery na yan, anong layer, at ano ang design ng pottery, then they will have a relative dating, tawag nila, hindi absolute. Yung absolute is, for example, today is October 7, 2020, the day of the Holy Rosary, the first day of the Novena to St. Margaret Mary, mga ganyan, this is Sacred Heart. Yun yung absolute dating. Yung relative dating is circa, around, ganyan. But more or less, they have already a dating. So, yan yung tinatawag nila na stratigraphy, yun ang gagawin ng mga scholars. Archaeologists. No. They are not biblical scholars, they are archaeologists. It happens that ang kanilang subject matter ng hinuhukay ay tell na related sa Bible. So, which is of course sometimes funded by universities or foundations. Para sa tinatawag na expedition para ma-excavate ang mga tell. So it's not a cheap work, no? Millions of dollars of course are spent, and you need a foundation or support of the government to do that, no? Kasi ang daming tell, halimbawa, kung yung tell na hinuhukay mo, hindi pala yun, halimbawa. Yung Jericho, huhukayin nila. Hindi pala yun yung Jericho nung panahon ng Jericho. Eh di, waste the love man. So, they have to really, parang minsan gamble yun. No? So, meron, kaya it's an independent science itself. It has something to do with the biblical scholars. The biblical scholars are fed with the data, and the data are interpreted, subjected into analysis by biblical scholars in comparison with what they have sa Bible. Okay? And so, ito yung halimbawa ng mga matatagpuan nila sa mga layers ng tell. At sa layers ng tell, malalagyan nila ng age or relative dating. For example, itong design na ito, usually yung mahahanap nila ay potsherds, mga banga, yung mga na minsan sa libro ni Job, you remember the book of Job, noong may sakit si Job na hindi naman COVID pero mukhang kakapandiri yung kanyang sakit, dahil sabi doon mula sa ulo hanggang kanyang sa talampakan ay puno ng galis, puno ng boils or puno ng skin disease. And then he was using a puncture, no? To scrape himself para mawala yung kati. No? So, batteries are indispensable materials or remains of the past ng mga potsherds na may mga design, kasi pag may mag-resign na ganyan, alam na nila kung kaninong design, kung anong culture ang design na yan. Alam nila kung design niya ng Canaanite, alam niya kung design niya ng Israelite, alam niya kung design niya ng Palestine, ng Philistines, yung si Goliath, na kultura ni Goliath. Alam nila yan kung ang design na kultura ng mga Griego, or outside, coming outside across the Mediterranean Sea, na design na yan. Alam nila yan kung made in China, or siguro, oh, we can compare that today. Halimbawa, meron kang gamit, tapos na, madaling masira. What do you say immediately? Made in China. So, parang that is the criteria that is being used here. Meron ng specific, they have agreed yung mga designs na yan belong to a particular date, especially if that potsherd ay natagpuan sa layer na wisok na collaborating yung date ng design. Oh, ito yung mga design ng mga pots. May mga highlights sila, o may mga drawing, o may mga yung rim, may hawakan. So, yung mga unang pots, wala pang hawakan, napaka-simple lang. So, walang design-design. So, yun yung mga earlier civilization. Na ito yung Jericho. When they are excavating until today, Jericho. Ang tawag sa sa area na suspected nila is Jericho ay Tel Es Sultan, which is the Arabic name. No? So, this is part of the city of Jericho, and the excavating. This is a fairly recent picture that I downloaded from the internet. Now, why Jericho we highlight? Kasi nga, di ba, sa Book of Joshua, they burned the city of Jericho. So, archaeologists would know na may burn, na burn yung city na yan if may mga indication na na-burn ang isang city. So, in order to collaborate na yung Jericho was really burned and the walls collapsed doon sa trumpet ng mga priests, the sound of the trumpets, then the shout of the people, walls collapsed, Jericho burned the city, then there must be some indications that they were destroyed, that they were burned. So yun yung isang motivation ng pagbukay sa Jericho. It's not only that, this is when we were students in 1997 at the Hebrew University, hindi naman kami archaeologists, but we did some six hours of archaeology every day, no? And they brought us to different sites in order to orient us kung anong ginagawa ng mga archaeologists, and yun nga, explaining how they date, in short, yung sinasummarize ko ngayon. Eh, wala ako dito kasi I was the one who took the pictures. Makita nyo, ruins, 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 ruins. You have to use your imagination kung ano yan, no? How do they know kung yan ay city? Yun na nga, may mga layers of indicators, and when excavate, they know the layers and what they found in those layers. This is me, 1997. Notice, I'm not advertising myself, but I want you to know the old city is one of the oldest cities in the world is Jericho, which is 2,200 to 2,000 BC, meaning the city already existed. And paano dinidefine ang isang city nung unang panahon? Katulad ng Quezon City, wall, mayroong fortress, no? Para hindi ma-penetrate ng enemy or ng wild animals, though they the stronger the walls are, the more advanced the city was. So city wall, and the city wall already existed in 2200 to 2000 BC. Kailan ba yung time ni Joshua? 13th century, meaning 1200 towards the end of the 13th century yung story ni Joshua, which is 1200, and you are 2200, you are what the city already existed before the time of Joshua, 1000 more than 1000 years before that, before Joshua came into existence, or before Joshua went to destroy Jericho. So there was already the city. So that is collaborated, that there was a city called Jericho existing already thousands of years before Joshua. But there are there indicators that those that city was destroyed during the time of Joshua, which is in the 13th century? That is a question that we will be answering next time, because it's already past 9 o'clock. So next time I will go and I will discuss, we begin to discuss the book of Joshua. After that long detour, an hour of detour, to widen a bit, to open a bit, before entering into and studying the literary writing, I mean the literary record, which is the book of Joshua. Now, I am not, I will be presenting not from my own notes, but from the lecture notes of a Jewish professor. She's famous until now. Sometimes she appears on CNN, and her expertise is really Christianity. She's a Jew, but his expertise is Christianity, Christian Bible. However, she had a video lecture, series of video lectures, and one of them is a section on Joshua. And so I would be using his notes, you know, forgive me for doing that, but there is no better way than she, a Jew, presenting the book in a, you know, 25-minute lecture. And some of the notes I already uploaded here, okay, uploaded on my website. So you go to my website, this one, and then that on the sidebar, my website, there's a sidebar there that says online Bible study. There I will be uploading the notes, because you have requested for it, no? That why are there no notes, no? Well, I will not upload my PowerPoint, because the PowerPoint is obviously copyrighted, meaning it's a personal notes. They are not notes really that are reviewed, notes that are corrected if there are typographical errors, which sometimes they have. No? So I will not be uploading my notes here, but the source, i-upload ko yung source. Kasi yun din ang nandiyan na si Father Ronnie Maleli, estudyante ko yung dati sa seminary, yun din ang lagi kong sabi sa mga seminarya. Kasi naghihintay na lang sila ng PowerPoint ng professor. Parang so, hindi na sila, ang minamaster nila yung PowerPoint ng professor. Hindi naman yun ang Word of God. Tsaka, we are bound also to fallibility. We are not infallible. No, you can commit many mistakes. Typographical, sometimes, kung ano lang ang, minsan, pag hindi mo ni-review, may mga nawala yung not, yung nawala yung not, supposed to be there. So, they are not to be considered as the sacrosanct text, holy text. They are there to guide you, but not really the ones that you should be waiting for. So, but there are notes that I will be uploading there that are sources. Yung source na pinanggalingan ng sinasabi ko, eh, mas reliable lang mga yun. So, I will upload them as we go on sa aking website. But, no? There's a big but and a big appeal. Do not please share them with the world, with the public, because it's for private use only. some of them are subject ng copyright. Kasi even if I bought the books, even I paid for them, you cannot just simply share them publicly. So do not overzealously share them, because they are, anyway, nilagay ko naman doon for private use only. Meron siyang watermark para hindi tayo ma-accus ng, it's only for private study like this. Kaya nga hindi natin pinapublic yung mga lectures natin, kasi nga some of them are ideas of others. And you know, in the professors, we know how it is in universities, that if it's not your idea, you must acknowledge those whose ideas are being used. So I will upload them yung mga notes, but once again, there's a big but and a big warning that you can upload them for personal use, pero huwag namang ilagay na sa ano, public consumption. Kasi nga, most of them, if not all, maliba lang siguro ako ang gumawa, no? Pero kahit ako pa ang gumawa, huwag mo na naman ipagkakalat. Kasi nga, first, baka may mga errors at it will reflect back sa nagturo o gumawa, di ba? So, kasi nga, pag hindi pa nire-review, hindi pa sinasubject into criticism yung critical reading, marami kang makikita na errors. So, hindi tayo infallible. That's not only a request, but really part of our code of ethics dito sa ating online Bible study. I hope yung mga bago na mga students are not turned off dahil masyado atang technical ngayong gabi. Pero I just presume na na-orient na kayo sa Pentateuch. Kaya yung mga newcomers natin, they will be helped a lot pag babalikan nila to review yung mga dinaanan natin na mga sessions. 10 sessions, pagtiyagaan nyo na lang yun. The better sessions are placed on YouTube, pero hindi lahat ay nalagay ko sa YouTube, because talaga naman napakahirap mag-edit pag ilagay na sa YouTube, lalo pag mabagal ang internet. So, tuloy yung sarili kung gusto nyong medyo makuha yung style ko na magturo at yung language na ginagamit ko, then meaning mga technical language na ginagamit, then try to go back sa mga earlier sessions natin. Kasi nga, may nagtanong kung open ba ang Bible study para sa mga hindi nakatapos o kaya mga bagong students. Yes, it's open. Only it should be in the private group like this. And kasi pwede namang i-review yung mga past lectures natin. Ala, paulit-ulit na yung mga sinasabi ko dito. Pero I have to stick to our agreement that when it's time to stop, we should stop. Christina Elgo, thank you, Father Randy, for sharing your resource, okay? For our initial understanding, thank you again. Thanks po, sabi ni the Genevieve Factao. Yeah, thank you. Okay, thank you. Sabi din ni Marimel Bautista. Lolit Ocampo, very interesting. Oh, salamat. May interesting. I thought it became boring. Can't wait for the next session. And Maricel Laurentino Dupaya, thank you, Father. So, let's call it a night. And once again, may the Lord keep you away from all harm and evil. And may the Blessed Mother, on the day of the Queen, she being the Queen of the Holy Rosary, intercede for the world, for us, as we are facing a big crisis. And may the Almighty God bless you all, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Ito po si Father Randy Flores ng Biblical Apostolate of the Diocese of Cubao, Secretariat Parish here in Quezon City. God bless you and good night. See you next week, next Wednesday. Bye-bye.